What is the largest living thing? That's a more complicated question than it seems, so let's break it down. We often think of a living thing as one individual, like one person, but what about your gut microbes? They make up a part of who you are. Also, you're made of trillions of cells. Are those each their own living thing? Does that mean that you, as an individual, are actually trillions of individuals? While we're at it, what does large mean? Do we mean long? Then the largest animal on Earth would probably be a siphonophore, a 40-meter-long gelatinous creature that lives in the ocean. Do we mean tall? Then the biggest would be a 116-meter-high redwood tree in California called Hyperion. See, it starts to get a little tricky to define when you look at it closely, but it's not impossible to identify the five most massive living things. Now that we've thoroughly confused ourselves, let's talk about what those are. And no, none of them are the blue whale. When I say fungus, what do you picture? I personally envision the fruiting body of a fungus, a mushroom. But not every fungus looks like your classic mushroom throughout its life cycle. And that's the case with our first example. It goes by many names. The honey fungus, Armillaria ostiae if we're getting fancy with it. But if we're being simply descriptive, it's also called the humongous fungus, because it's, well, humongous. Now, this species of fungus can be found in a few different regions of North America, Europe, and Asia. But the largest version is located in the mountains of Oregon in the Malheur National Forest. It's called a genet, which is a colony of fungi that come from a single organism. And this genet is huge. When it was measured several years ago, it covered nearly 10 square kilometers and potentially weighed as much as 32,000 metric tons. That's three times as much as the Eiffel Tower. How did it get so big? Well, the honey fungus has something called rhizomorphs, which are these long, thin, root-like structures that spread underground. Not all fungi have these structures, and in the honey fungus and other Armillaria species, they seem to be especially good at spreading. These rhizomorphs allow one individual to live longer and spread farther than it would by simply using spores. Despite being so large, the honey fungus is mostly hidden from sight, lurking underground and only revealing itself with actual mushrooms when it's time to reproduce. Being able to grow so big and cover such a large area can only be a good thing for the fungus. Unfortunately, it's bad news for trees. The honey fungus is a tree's worst nightmare, growing under its bark and attacking its root system. In fact, the Oregon genet is considered the largest root disease center in the world. A root disease center is an area where many trees have died from root disease and others are in decline. Simply put, it's the worst place in the world to be a tree. You may not think of a single fungus as being big enough to take down an entire forest, but we have to give credit where credit is due. And fungi aren't the only unassuming behemoths on our planet. Next, let's take a look at an even more massive ocean plant. If you've ever driven through the suburbs, you've probably seen some pretty pristine lawns of grass. Believe it or not, fish have lawns too. Well, sort of. Seagrass is a type of marine plant that can grow into big, beautiful beds for fish to play in. And sometimes these beds are a single organism. Off the coast of Australia, there is an enormous bed of Posidonia australis, or Poseidon's ribbonweed. And that bed is a clonal colony, so it's all technically one individual. The whole thing has the same DNA. It covers about 200 square kilometers, about the size of 28,000 soccer fields. In 2022, the Guinness Book of World Records named it the largest clonal colony of a marine plant. An oddly specific superlative, but informative nonetheless. With enough seagrass to cover the lawns of an entire suburban community, you better believe this bed is home to a bunch of marine organisms. It's basically an entire habitat, providing food for herbivores like endangered dugongs and sea turtles, and a home for smaller animals like fish and invertebrates. Now, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but given that I'm hosting this video, it seems I have no choice. Unfortunately, climate change has not been kind to this poor seagrass. The bed has begun to dwindle, as an increase in heat waves and storms take their toll on it. One day, it may lose its weird title as largest clonal colony of a marine plant. But for now, this large patch of Posidonia australis reigns supreme. Since we're talking about clonal colonies of plants, it'd be borderline irresponsible if we didn't discuss Pando. Latin for I spread, Pando is a grove of quaking aspen trees. Or rather, a grove of quaking aspen tree located near Salt Lake City, Utah. I say tree because this entire forest is one huge clonal colony that stemmed from a single seed. That seed is believed to have begun its journey towards setting records during the last ice age. Over the last 12,000 years, Pando spread far and wide via suckering, where new stems shoot up from the roots, producing a lot of genetically identical trees that share one enormous root system. Aspen trees aren't the only trees that grow by suckering. Willows, fig trees, and others can sucker. But the aspen's ability to flourish in a wide variety of environments and its tendency to quickly colonize and survive after fires may contribute to its ability to persist in these large clonal colonies for so long. Today, the grove is home to 40,000 tree trunks and weighs almost 6,000 metric tons. But like the giant seagrass bed, Pando is in danger. With diseases such as root rot eating away at it and herbivores stunting growth and regeneration, Pando is beginning to shrink. That's also true for our next example, which is even larger and weirder than a forest made of a single tree.
You want to learn more about how human ingenuity can address the problems our world is facing? Well, with Study Hall's new sustainability course, you can work towards a more sustainable future while earning college credit right here on YouTube. Here's how it works. Watch the sustainability course videos on the Study Hall channel for free. Then sign up for an online college course led by ASU faculty for just $25 and apply what you've learned. If at the end of the course you're happy with your grade, you pay $400, about a third of the cost of a college course, to get 3 transferable college credits on your transcript. Whether you're trying to learn more about sustainable food production and distribution, earn college credit, or just prove to yourself that you can do it, Study Hall can help you reach your goals without the financial risk. Check out the link in the description or head over to gostudyhall.com to learn more.
Now we're going to start playing with our definition of organism a little bit more. Maybe it's a stretch, but work with me here because it's fun to think about. Our fourth example is the Great Barrier Reef. This famous reef, which can be seen from space, stretches across 2,300 kilometers of seafloor off the coast of Australia in the Coral Sea, which is a fitting name for it given that it's home to the world's largest coral reef. You may be asking how this is a singular living thing. And that's a fair question, given that it's technically made up of close to 3,000 smaller reefs and countless organisms. But these reefs are so interconnected that the Great Barrier Reef has been recognized by UNESCO as the world's largest living structure. It's what some scientists call a superorganism. A superorganism is a group of organisms working together to accomplish tasks, but the group is so integrated that they're basically not able to survive without each other. In the Great Barrier Reef's case, the corals, algae, and microbes like bacteria are all essential to the reef's existence, much like our own cells and gut microbiota are essential to ours. For example, beneficial bacteria on coral reefs can protect corals from pathogens by making antimicrobial compounds and outcompeting them for space on the surface of the corals. And many corals need algae to live. The algae provides them with food by carrying out photosynthesis. This gives the corals fuel for processes like growth of the coral's tissues and hard skeletons. Without the algae and microbes that live in close association with corals, they wouldn't be able to live, let alone build the stuff you can see from space. So, while it may seem like a bit of a reach, it isn't unreasonable to consider the Great Barrier Reef one enormous living thing. Now that we've stretched our definitions, let's go even further and discuss the Gaia hypothesis. The idea was conjured up in the 1970s by James Lovelock and Lynn Margulis, and it proposes that our entire planet is one large living thing, basically the biggest superorganism. Think about it like this. Life on Earth arose about 3 billion years ago. That's billion with a B. And while life has changed a lot over all that time, the Earth's processes, whether they be chemical, physical, or biological, have continued to foster life even as it has changed. Our atmosphere is self-sustaining too. Plants take in carbon dioxide and release oxygen into the atmosphere via photosynthesis. Animals take in oxygen and release carbon dioxide via respiration. Microbes take nitrogen from the atmosphere and turn it into something usable by other microbes. And some microbes move nitrogen the opposite way, putting it back into its atmospheric form. These are just a few examples of processes that sustain life on Earth by recycling essential elements through our atmosphere and oceans. Basically, living things interact and evolve together with non-living things to make a self-sustaining organism. Not unlike how living things such as cells and bacteria interact with non-living things like water and the air you breathe to create a self-sustaining organism. You. Now, Margulis and Lovelock's evidence that the Earth is one large living thing may not be as concrete or convincing to some people as the arguments for our other examples. But it provides us with an opportunity to look at our planet from a more holistic perspective, which can benefit Earth sciences as a whole. So even if you don't fully believe in the Gaia hypothesis, it's still a fun thought experiment. Makes me wonder if our cells have their own hypotheses about us being giant living things. And there you have it, the 5 largest living things on Earth. Or rather, 4 of the largest living things on Earth and Earth itself. I personally was not expecting a planet to be on this list when I started researching and writing it, but I guess it's no weirder than a fungus the size of a town.